Okay, so I think we can start slowly. I think we have most of the participants here, I think. Okay. Okay, so let's start with another topic, INC and electrical systems. We have, in fact, two, let's say, lessons. One about INC, one about electrical. I was asked to prepare, let's say, presentation on both of these topics. So I decided to merge them together into one presentation. So we will speak in parallel about INC and electrical systems, because in fact, the same, let's say, basic design principles and requirements apply on both of them. So during the presentation, in fact, you will again hear the same, let's say, basic design principles as you have already heard in the previous presentations. But now we deal mainly, okay, how to implement these, let's say, general design requirements into the electrical and INC systems. So this will be, let's say, another part to the, let's say, puzzle of the engineering assessment. So we will speak about INC and electrical systems together in both of the next lessons. So here, then, and then after now, and then after the lunch. I will always, let's say some specific things concerning INC and electrical systems. I know there are some, let's say, INC and electrical engineers as well here. So from the point of view of INC or electrical systems itself, we will really scratch the surface, yeah, because it's very broad topics. There are many, we can spend 1 month speaking just about INC or electrical systems. So we will focus on basic design principles and how they are applied in these kind of systems. So it will be just, let's say, overview from the point of view of INC and electrical systems. So let's skip this. Okay, so let's start with some overview. So instrumentation and control, in short INC, I think everyone knows this abbreviation, is some sort of, let's say, central nervous system of the plant. So it can, let's say, feel the sense, the technology parameters, and then based on some predefined algorithms to actuate, to influence the technology itself. So basically the INC systems are here or are in the plant to control or limit plant conditions during normal or abnormal conditions, and also to achieve the safe shutdown state of the plant. So we have INC systems specifically also for the, let's say, accident conditions as well. So this is, let's say, from the point of view of safety. So the INC systems have, let's say, direct impact on the safety of the plant. And also, they can have impact on the, let's say, cost of the effectiveness, because there are some systems which are used, let's say, as a support for the production, and some reliability or availability of the systems can, let's say, impact the electricity production, because it's clear that the main goal of nuclear power plant is to produce electricity and to, let's say, make some profit as well. Yeah. So, but we will not speak about, let's say, economic part of the problem. We will focus on the safety, yeah, in this presentation, because we have to evaluate the safety and the operation of the plant has to be safe. Yeah. This is the basic requirement. And of course, most of the INC systems, or let's say all of them, will not work if they will have no, let's say, power supply. So usually together the electric systems are, let's say, essential part of the safety as well, because the INC systems are, let's say, active system, electrical, let's say, systems itself. So we have to power supply them. So we can't, let's say, split it into, and we will speak about both of them in a parallel. Just maybe small remark, most of the, let's say, information I took from the new revisions of safety guides, DS 430, it's the draft of the new safety guide for design of electric system. I think it was not yet issued, but I think it will be very soon by the IEA. I think it's in final state. I think it was already approved, I think. And then DS431, you will see this, let's say, these references throughout the presentation. At the end, you will have the list, so you everything you have in the presentation here. So DS431 is the draft of safety guide for INC system design. So the most often I use these two drafts of new, let's say, safety guides to explain, okay, how to deal with different, let's say, basic safety requirements in these types of systems. So it's just for your information. Okay. So let's start with INC systems. So this is some, basic scheme, how it can look like. So basically we have some technological process here, and then we have some, measurements, some sensors, which are able to read, to check, to sense the parameters of this process. And then in the system itself, there are some predefined algorithms, some logic, which evaluates the state of the technology and provide some feedback, some action throughout the actuators, which can be pumps, valves, or some motors or whatever. So this is called, the control loop. So it is some sort of loop. So it influences the process and then reads it again, and it goes again and again. So usually we distinguish, two, big parts of the systems. So we have the control or the operational control. So these systems are used for the, normal operation. We have a lot of different systems for reactor power control, turbo generator control. Different equipment have some small control systems just for, the equipment itself. So we can find many such systems on the plant. But we also have, the specific, safety systems. Specific requirements are imposed on the safety systems. We already know about it. Such as single failure criterion and common cause failure, So we will speak about these requirements throughout the presentation, but this is another group of the systems. They also work on the, similar example, similar principle. So they have the, sensors. They evaluate the state of the technology, and based on some predefined logic, if it's necessary, if some, limits are exceed, so they provide some safety action. So the big difference between these two are not only the specific requirements, because these systems have to be, more reliable, because they have to deal with some, accidental conditions. But also some specific is that these systems usually work, continuously, or it's sometimes called high demand. So it always, is in full operation, but usually these systems works in, on demand. So only if some, specific combination of inputs occurs, so then the action is here, really specific actions. So most of the time, the systems, in fact, do nothing. They just observe the technology and evaluate if some limits are not exceed. So this has some, implications. For example, we usually, when something wrong happens here, we usually immediately know that because the system is in full operation. But we have to more focus on, surveillance testing of this safety systems to see that, okay, they are still capable to do something, because usually they just sit and observe the situation. And also another big difference is the price. Yeah? These systems are much more expensive, yeah? So this is, I think, clear. Another important thing, these systems usually not only control the technology, but they provide information to the people, to the operators. This is a very important part. I think in the past, it was quite often underestimated. I think after Three Mile Island, much focus was put to this part here. because the humans have to interact with these systems and they have to get, let's say, proper information. They have to get the information. They are able to understand, evaluate what is, let's say, the state. And if some manual action is required, so they have to have means to provide the actions and also to have, let's say, information to decide if the action is needed. So the human machine or human system interface is a very important part of the systems as well. So this is, let's say, some basic principles of the INC systems. Any question to this? Okay, here's, let's say, more specific example with some pictures, to have some nice pictures here as well. So basically, this is the same thing which was in the previous slide, so I will not speak very, very long about this. So here you have, let's say, the standard control systems with some specific, let's say, sensors. Here can be some logic and some actuators. As I have mentioned, so usually these systems are connected to some upper level. So this is, let's say, very often called, let's say, supervisory or operator level. This is, let's say, control level. This is some field level. Here's the so-called field instrumentation. It means sensors and so on. We can have also situation when we have, for example, some direct measurements. So the, let's say, sensor itself, let's say, provide some direct measurements to the control level, to the, let's say, main or emergency control room or whatever. And there can be also, let's say, some specific dedicated, let's say, direct means to directly operate some equipment. So here's the picture of the control room. I think you saw such pictures many times. What is important, usually all the equipments are connected in some sort of, let's say, digital or computer systems to, let's say, gather all the informations. And very often they are also connected to some higher level, some, let's say, corporation or the plant network, which then is used, for example, with, by some departments like economical department, some, I don't know, technology department to evaluate the state of the equipment and management of the plant to see the key, let's say, indicators of the plant and so on. So usually you will find that all the systems are connected somehow. And that's why also the cybersecurity is a very big concern nowadays. And if we have enough time, so at the end of the second lesson, I would like to spend some time with the cybersecurity as well, because it's quite a hot topic nowadays. And it's basically because computer-based systems are used, interconnected, because very often here it's connected to the corporate network, to the emails, to the internet, and things like that. What I would like to mention, there are also systems which perhaps don't have any actuators. They are just for the monitoring. So they have some, let's say, sensors, maybe some, let's say, logic, how to evaluate the state of the sensors, and they provide the information to the people. So typically it's, for example, post-accident monitoring or radiation monitoring systems, because usually you don't have any specific means how to control, or you control through another systems, but there can be also monitoring systems as well. Such systems are used also for electrical grid, for example. Yes, you have nowadays in electrical, let's say, buses, you have some, let's say, specific, let's say, transformers, which provide you information about the state of the, let's say, power in different, let's say, parts of your electrical grid or electrical buses of your plant. So also, in the past, there was some, let's say, strict division between electrical systems. Usually the electrical people usually don't speak much about with INC people and vice versa. But nowadays, it like somehow, let's say, interconnect and blends, because the same technology is used not only for the, let's say, technology, the pipes and the steam and water and whatever, but also for the electrical part of the plant itself. So let's focus also on the, let's say, electrical part. So the core part of the, let's say, electrical scheme is the, let's say, turbo generator. So basically the main reason is that, okay, it's here to produce the electricity and to send it to the offsite grid and to make some profit. But so this is, let's say, some economic point of view. But we will speak about the safety. Eh? We need the electricity to provide the supply for the INC systems to be able to work, to be able to provide the safety functions. So we have the interconnections from the turbine, which is able to supply the, let's say, the systems important to safety. And we also have, and it's recommended to have some, let's say, backup offsite power connection, because this connection is not used not only to, let's say, sell or provide the electricity to the offsite grid, but also it's used when the turbine is, let's say, stopped, and it's during the outages or for whatever reason it can happen. It's not very, let's say, unintended. It's quite, let's say, credible event. So then we need some, let's say, additional source of power. So usually we use the offsite power to supply the systems important to safety. And if this is for any reason unavailable, we should have some, let's say, backup offsite power, which is perhaps, let's say, not designed for the same loads, because it's not used for the, let's say, as a normal output point for the distribution of electricity, but it can be used just for the, let's say, load of the, let's say, inside equipment. So this black part, it's called preferred power supply. And preferred, it's what normally we use. Yeah, this is something which we won't use which we will use normally. So the source from the turbine is, let's say, house load or the offsite grid. Okay, for the safety systems, we also have this red part, some, let's say, backup, some safety power supply, which is backed by some standby or backup diesel generators. So we have diesel generators. If we lose the preferred power supply, so we have to be able to supply the safety systems from, let's say, another source. So generally, we have as many, let's say, standby diesel generators, as many, let's say, safety trains of safety system we have. We will speak about it later as well. And we have to be able to, let's say, to keep it in operation. What was also done recently, so it was found out that, let's say, station blackout, it's quite, let's say, and design extension conditions based on Fukushima, it's okay, some credible event, it could happen. So we have to also deal with some design extension conditions. So it can happen that also these diesel generators are not available. So recently, some, let's say, alternate power supply was added to the design, or in the, let's say, existing plant, it's also built as a new, some specific feature. It's in a new build. It should be included from the beginning. So it's some alternative diverse source of electric power. So it can be some, let's say, another diesel generator from which is placed somewhere else. Very often there are some mobile diesel generators with some specific connection provided and qualified for this type of event. And what we also have in the plant, we spoke about, let's say, AC power, yeah? But normally the, let's say, the computer-based, the digital systems, the INC systems, the instrumentation is, let's say, supplied from DC power. So, of course, normally the DC part of the electrical grid is, let's say, supplied through, let's say, transformers from the, let's say, preferred power supply, so from the turbine or from the either one offsite or another offsite, let's say, power source. It can be also supplied from the diesel generators, but we also have batteries, some UPS, some uninterruptible, let's say, power supply, some backup to be able to provide the power supply for, let's say, very important systems during the time, for example, before or during the time or before the diesel this generator could be, let's say, connected and start to feed these systems, or to, let's say, survive the time till we are able to put here some another, let's say, alternate source. So we have also batteries, which are used for, let's say, some portion of the, let's say, safety systems to be able to survive, to supply them, to get the information, to be able to properly, to keep the plant in the safe state also during these transients when we need to, let's say, start the diesels or, let's say, attached or connect these alternate power supplies. So this is, let's say, basic scheme. What usually you can find in, let's say, every power plant, it's usually much more, let's say, complicated, but basically this is how it works. Okay, safety classification, we already know about it, so I think it's not necessary to speak about it again. So just to remind you, so we have to identify all the items and let's say based on their safety significance. So again, it's about graded approach. So not all the equipment of the plant, not all INC or electrical systems of the plant have the same safety significance. So we have to, let's say, classify them. It's the same process as was shown before. And of course, we have to design these systems based on the, let's say, requirements, which are, let's say, specific for the safety class in which they are, let's say, labeled. So it's clear that the safety, the class one, will have the more strict reliability requirements than, for example, class two or three. So I think this is clear. Maybe just, I think, some note that even if many standards, we speak about, for example, INC systems, their classification and things like that, we always have to think about their power supplies. Yeah, and the electricity part of the, which is important to the safety, needs to have the same classification, same requirements as the systems to which it serves. Yeah, because if it's not so good, so we can lose it, and then we, as a consequence, we can lose also the, let's say, the safety system and the safety function itself. So this is, I think, quite clear, let's say, assumption. Okay, you have already seen this, so I think it's not important to, let's say, speak for a long time about this. So just basically, so the plant equipment is divided into items which are not important to safety. So from the safety point of view, we do not care, and the items which are important to safety.
For safety classification, we have safety class 1 to 3.
Yeah. Okay, I will show you another picture. Basically, what we have seen about the, let's say, IEA approach to classification, it basically applies to all equipment. So not only, let's say, machinery equipment or construction, it applies also to the, let's say, INC or electrical equipment. But in the different states, there are some different classification schemes based on different standards. What we have mentioned, 1E or non-1E, this is the American IEEE standard used for classification. And it's not, let's say, fully compliant with the IEA view of the classification. Another picture I will show you. Maybe I will then go back. So you have different, let's say, classification scheme for INC and electrical system as well. So for IEA, this is some, let's say, the approach of IEA, it is not updated. So now there's a new safety guide which speaks about class 1, 2, and 3, we know. Very often is used IEC standard, which, let's say, basically, let's say, copy the idea of the, let's say, nowadays IEA view. But there are different standards in different countries how to, let's say, categorize or classify the INC and electrical systems. And so the idea, the basic idea is the same, to have graded approach, to find out what is more important, and to apply the specific requirement for the most important systems. But the frontiers between the systems are maybe not exactly the same. And yes, you very often you can spend some time if you, for example, in one of our plant, we use this IEC scheme. In another plant, which the INC was built by Westinghouse, we use this scheme. And it's not always easy to find the connection in between. Yeah, you have to some let's say evaluate and, but the basic approach, the idea behind it, it's the same. Yeah, but the classes, it's maybe called a little bit different. And so here during the presentation, we will let's say stay with the let's say general IEA view, but you can find many different approaches. Yeah, and okay. Okay, I cannot say. Basically, the most for the let's say the first category or the one category or whatever is called. So this is the most strict requirement, and they should be so strict that they should let's say. I don't personally evaluate all of them, and I'm not sure if such evaluation has been done. But usually, every specific let's say classification scheme. Use the let's say the basic design principles derived from IEA. So usually you will find for each of this group which is the most strict. For example, the defense in depth, the single ferrule, common cause ferrule, and things like that. But there can be some differences because, for example, as was mentioned during the let's say presentation about classification. So for example, IEEE it has let's say two groups, IEC it has three groups. So, for example, something which is called category B here could fall under 1E here, and something could fall under, let's say, important to safety, but not 1E. So there could be some differences. Eh? But the reason is to implement the graded approach to identify the most important equipment and to apply the strict, let's say, reliability requirements on the, let's say, specific equipment only. Eh? This is a really good question. I think every operator thinks about this. I think there is no simple answer because, for example, if the manufacturer is used to produce the systems according to the IEEE standards, so they use not only the classification, but they use only all the, let's say, design codes, for example, codes or standards for computer design and things like that, based on IEEE standards. You, if you compare, for example, with IEC, you will find out that it's very similar. But if you ask the supplier that he has to, let's say, check and evaluate the, let's say, compliance, so it will cost some more money, eh? Because you have to check, you have to evaluate. There will be maybe some discrepancies. So you have to think about it, what to apply. So usually it's the choice to let's say key to let's say chose one let's say classification scheme and the corresponding codes and to keep it consistent. Eh? But very often it's not possible because we have different suppliers from different maybe countries. So very often we will have to deal with some. And not only in the classification, perhaps they will use some specific design codes, yeah, for based on IEEE, and you would like to see if it complies with IEC and so on. So I think no easy answer is here. This is the problem that the, let's say, legislation all around the world is not the same. In different countries, there are differences. They are not very big. Usually you can find the compliance, but you have spent some time and money on that. Yeah? So I think the trend is to try to somehow, let's say, cooperate more to have, let's say, similar requirements all around the world. But this is, let's say, almost impossible. It's very difficult. And yeah, this is, it's a big problem for everyone, for suppliers, for operators, for regulators, for everyone. Every country has some specific requirements. This is a problem. It would be better if it will be the one legislation for all, but unfortunately it isn't there. And then it costs money. Yeah, more effort, more resources, because we have to think about different standards and how they are, let's say, compliant to each other. Yeah, sure. So I don't want to spend, we can discuss a lot of time, because it's really a big problem, yeah, the legislation. So I just would like to, let's say, here in this slide to speak more about what kind of, let's say, INC and electrical systems we have, to give you some idea about some specific systems. So for the safety systems, so usually what we have is something called protection system. Protection system, it usually includes two, let's say, subsystems. Sometimes there are implemented as two separate systems. Sometimes there are, let's say, as a one protection system. So one part is reactor trip system. Reactor trip system has, let's say, the only goal to scram the reactor. If there is some specific combination of the inputs, it shut down the reactor, and this is the, let's say, goal of this specific system. Very easy task, one task, and it has to be provided. Then we have something called Engineering Safety Actuator System, SFAS, which, let's say, provides the function how to, let's say, keep the plant in the safe shutdown and to, let's say, cool the core, containment isolation, containment heat removal. So all these functions we have already mentioned in some, let's say, specific, let's say, presentations before, for example, the reactor cooling, the containment sprinkles or sprays. Usually these actuators are driven by the SFAS, Engineering Safety Actuator System, which is usually considered as a part of the so-called protection system. What is also important to say, there is no international consensus how the, let's say, ideal INC architecture should look like. There are different approaches how we can implement that. We will speak about some examples. But there is no consensus, there is no, let's say, one recommended architecture of the INC systems. There can be different solutions. Different suppliers have different solutions which can work. So you can find really differences in between the plants. But the functions, nevertheless, if the system is included in one or two or how it's designed, so the protection system is somewhere in the plant implemented. From the point of view of electrical systems, what we have usually here, or what we have here, is something called emergency load sequencer. It's something when, for example, we have to, let's say, switch to the diesel generators, and we need some big pumps to operate to cool the reactor and the containment. So we have to, let's say, load the diesel generator step by step, because we don't want to overload it. So we have some, let's say, logic to load the diesel generator step by step, not to lose it just in the first second. Eh? So there are also some specific functions for, let's say, the electric part of the plant as well. From the point of view of electric, for example, cables and so on, we have also, let's say, containment penetrations. And just to remind you that containment penetrations are part of the safety systems. Even if the cable belongs to the maybe items which is not important to safety, it can be some, let's say, some information system there. So the penetration itself is safety system, and it's not because of the cable itself, but because of its containment. Eh? So just this small note. Okay, skip this. Okay, so now to the basic. So we will again speak about the, let's say, basic requirements and how it is applied in the let's say INC systems and electrical systems. So defense in depth. We have heard a lot about this principle. So we know that we have to, let's say, implement, let's say, multiple barriers to protect us as much as possible. So the idea is not new. You can see the old castles, the old fortresses, they did exactly what we are trying to do now. Yeah? So they had multiple walls, multiple barriers, maybe walls, some water in between. So they use independent walls, some different, let's say, materials, different approaches to protect themselves. And the approach in the INC or LTCL system is completely the same. So basically, we have as a one level, and I will explain in more details in other slides. We have some control systems for normal operation. If something bad happens, so we have perhaps some limitation system which can limit certain conditions. We have reactor trip system, or let's say reactor protection system, which includes reactor trip and engineering safety actuators, so the cooling, containment, isolation, and things like that, as a, let's say, another, let's say, layer in defense in depth. If something bad happens here and the systems on lower level are not able to cope with it, we have some post-accident monitoring, which can help me to, let's say, provide some, for example, some additional systems for control of the plant during some, for example, severe accidents. So this is basic principle of the defense in depth. So also for INC and electrical systems, defense in depth has to be implemented. Yeah, we can't, let's say, degrade the defense in depth concept of the plant just implementing one big INC system, which when we fail, when if it fail, then it all, let's say, levels in depth are, let's say, degraded. So that's why we have more different, let's say, systems in the plant. So this is the defense in depth. It's somehow based on the possible state of the plant. So this is the, let's say, original, how the old or existing plants were built. So we already know that something called, which was called before, was called some beyond design basis, some severe accidents, which was not considered in the existing designs. So after the Fukushima, there's some evolution of the requirements. So now we have some design extension conditions, which now we should, let's say, consider in our design as well. And it was explained in the presentation by Marco, I think, Monday. So I will not go into the details to let's say, confuse you with some thoughts about it. But just to remind that basically we start with normal operation, then we have some anticipated operational occurrence. So it's something which is not, let's say, normal, but which can, let's say, happen quite often. So it's, for example, turbine trip, some electrical transients, and things like that. We have the design basis accidents. So it's basically the LOCA help and so on. And these types of accidents, there can be some combinations of accidents. And then we have design extension conditions. So we have different plant states, and we should have different, let's say, INC systems together with some, let's say, electrical systems to provide the power to cope with different plant states. So I found this, let's say, nice table. I don't know, maybe it's not very readable, so I just explain a little bit, and then you can read it in the presentation, and you can find more information. For example, Venera, it's free. You can download from the internet some description of this principle of defense in depth. So basically, for normal operation, we have the control systems. So the control systems are used to maintain the plant in the normal operating limits. They are used continuously. They provide some information to the operator. And this is what is used in normal operation. So from the point of view of personnel, they just, let's say, monitor and then check the state is okay. For these types of events, so anticipated operational occurrences, so some, let's say, abnormal situations, we have, let's say, something which it's usually called some limitation systems. Very often they are quite, let's say, connected together with the control systems. And as I said, there are no, let's say, ideal design. So in some designs, you will find, let's say, the limitation systems or limitation functions implemented let's say, as a subsystem of the, let's say, this control part. In some design, you will find it as a some, let's say, specific subsystem of, for example, reactor protection system. So there are different approaches how to do that. What is important, usually we have, or we should have some, let's say, systems which are able to cope with these types of situation and to prevent, to worsen the situation, to go here. We always try to, let's say, stay here and go back to the normal operation. We don't want to, let's say, lose the plant conditions and to go to more severe conditions. So we try to avoid them. So that's why we implement this, let's say, levels. So the level 3 is, let's say, basically the design basis events or combination of design basis events. So for this, we have the reactor protection system. So it's reactor tip system together with engineering safety features actuation. Usually there is some, let's say, diverse actuation system. So when we will speak about the common cause failure, we will see why it is implemented as a diverse. So very often there's a diverse system or diverse means to which provides the operator the possibility to manually control certain aspects of the plant or certain safety equipment in the case there is some problem in this level. And then we have these design extension conditions. So this is quite, let's say, a new concept. So we should have, let's say, consider some additional features for these design extension conditions. Usually for the existing plant, there are, let's say, thinking to implement something more, some, let's say, usually some, let's say, mobile equipment which can be used when necessary. Let's say some specific, for example, severe accident monitoring system. So some hardened, instrumentation which is able to survive severe accidents and to provide the information. So there are some approaches, and it's not yet, let's say, fully described in the let's say standards and guideline yet. But it's something which we have to think about. Okay, so maybe more specific information about electrical systems. I didn't find such a nice table about electrical, so I have to create one. It's not so nice, but maybe it will be, I hope it will be okay for you. So again, we have, let's say, the expected states of the plant and the, let's say, the systems which we have to cope with the situation. So basically in normal operation, we use the preferred power supply. So we have reliable grid, we have, let's say, on-site or off-site power. During the abnormal operation, so for example, where the turbine is tripped and stopped, so we usually use, or we have the household possibilities, it means we are able to, for example, use the backup off-site power. Or on the other hand, if, for example, off-site grid is lost, so we can use the turbo generator just for house load. So we decrease the, let's say, power of the reactor of the turbine, and we use the electricity production just for the house load. So we have to be able to cope with these, let's say, types of transients. In the case of design basis accidents, so what we usually have, so it's our, let's say, the backup diesel generators to provide the electricity to the safety systems. Because in this level, the safety systems are in operation, reactor tip, SFAS, and so on. So we have diesel generators, perhaps together with the batteries, which help to survive the transient between switching of the, for example, off-site to the diesel generators. And then for the deck design extension conditions, so as I have already mentioned before, some alternate power supply is introduced to the plant. So it's very often some mobile or some diverse source of, in, let's say, power. Together with perhaps, let's say, increase the battery capacity, because if you use some, let's say, mobile equipment and you have to bring it, say, for example, for some offsite to the plant and connect it and start it, so perhaps it will take more time than the on-site diesel. So we perhaps need more capacity of the battery to survive these, let's say, transients. Okay. So station blackout, it's some, let's say, typical or let's say some, let's say, important consideration from the point of view of electricity. We have already, let's say, mentioned this. So station blackout means that we lost the preferred supply, so it means turbine, offside grid. And with concurrent unavailability of the emergency AC power, so it means the standby diesel generators. So, and the experience shows that these situations can happen. Even if I have a lot of diesel generators, it can happen. So consideration has to be, let's say, done how to deal with a station blackout situation. So these are some, let's say, usual approaches, or combination of approaches of what is usually done. So increasing the capacity of the batteries, let's say, to survive more time, to have enough time to, let's say, do some action, to provide some, let's say, offside power or some mobile, let's say, units. Unit-to-unit connections. So if you have the plant which has multiple units, so you can have some specific unit-to-unit connections, because it can happen that, for example, in one unit, some diesel generators are still alive, so you can, let's say, interconnect and use them. And as I have mentioned, there are some diverse or some alternate AC power sources. So what is important, they have to be protected to the, let's say, events which can cause the station blackout. So at Fukushima, if it was, for example, flooding, so we have to put the diesel generator to some, let's say, sealed compartment or to some higher elevation or to reinforced compartment, not to be, let's say, harmed by, for example, falling objects and so on. So consideration have to be put that we don't want to lose the alternate AC power source together with the, let's say, diesel generators. So, okay, this is just some examples. So this is some alternate AC power in some reinforced container. These are some mobile units. You can have also some small, let's say, mobile units which can be carried by human just to supply an electricity only to some very specific, let's say, equipment. So let's say the combination of all of these can be used. It depends on the strategy and what the plant, let's say, prepare and create for such events. But what is important, we have to think and consider that such events can happen and have some, let's say, means and strategy how to deal with such event. Okay, so let's speak about another. So this was about, let's say, defense in depth, basically. So now let's speak about another important, let's say, design requirement for the INC and electrical systems. And this is simplicity. It looks simple, and it's not so simple, but it requires that the systems should be as simple as possible. And we should avoid unnecessary complexity. Why? Because if the system is very complex, and usually the INC systems, electrical as well, but the INC is typical for the INC, is too complex, so then it's not possible to test it in full extent because it's so complex that you are not able to have 100% test coverage. And so there is the possibility that there is some fault in the system which we cannot find because it's very complex. So we try to build the systems as easy, as simple as possible to be able to test it and to eliminate the possibility that there's some hidden fault in the systems. So this is the, let's say, very, let's say, specific and important requirements, because it would be easy to put all the functions in one computer systems. Nowadays, your mobile phone is able to implement all the functions of the plant mostly, but we don't want to do that because it will be very complex and we will not be able to, let's say, evaluate and test it and check and surveillance the equipment to see that everything is okay. So we try to keep it simple. Yeah. And it's not only for the, let's say, operator itself, but it's also for the regulator, because also regulator has to evaluate, let's say, what the operator has done. And with very complex systems, it's complicated, and there's a risk of hidden faults. So this is the reason for the simplicity. So now, single failure criterion. You already know that. So we have to consider that every safety group has to consider single failure criterion. What is safety group? Safety group is some general term. In different designs, you can find division or chain or whatever. It's a group of equipment from the, let's say, sensors or whatever, through the, let's say, logic to the actuators. So the whole group of equipment, which is necessary to provide the safety functions. So in all these chain, we have to consider that something can fail. Whatever it is, but we have to consider deterministically that something can fail. Even if the probability is not very high, but okay, this is deterministic criterion, and we have to think and consider that something can fail. So something can fail. If it fails, so it can have consequences. So together with, let's say, failed equipment, it can have some consequences on other equipment, so we have to consider such consequences. We have to consider failures imposed on the postulated events for which the equipment is intended to work. So, for example, if the equipment is intended to work during, for example, help or LOCA situation, so we have to be able to, let's say, and we have mentioned it during the qualification, so we have to consider that during this, or let's say, during such event, the equipment will be able to survive. Yeah. And what we have also, let's say, what we have to consider that we have to do some maintenance. You know that there, for example, can be some maintenance, something can fail, we have to, let's say, repair. There can be some maintenance because of the, let's say, equipment qualification, some requirements to replace something. So we have to consider that some part of the equipment could be, let's say, bypassed or put offsite, offline because of the maintenance. So these are the consideration about the, let's say, single failure criterion. So let's have a look, okay, some more specific example how to deal with it. So I think it's clear, and it's, let's say, practice, that with single failure criterion, we deal using redundancy. So simply, if we have to consider that something can fail here, so we put more of this. Yeah? So we have multiple equipment, and if one fail, so we have another one. So it's okay. This is the, let's say, the basic approach how to deal with redundancy. So the question is, how many of these I will need? In some design, you can find 3, in some 4, maybe for some specific system only 2. So what are the, let's say, requirements, or how will I find that, okay, this number is sufficient for me? So there are 2 point of views. How is, let's say, the deterministic, which we will speak about. So it means the single failure criterion, the maintenance. So this is some deterministic assumption. I will speak about it. And another is also some, let's say, probabilistic, some reliability. Because, for example, I can have some reliability requirement of some specific safety function. And the reliability requirement can be such that with one system, I'm not able to reach it. So I have to put more system to, let's say, improve the reliability of this specific safety function. So this is, let's say, some, let's say, probabilistic, or let's say, point of view of how many redundancies I need. But okay, let's speak about the single failure criterion. So it's deterministic. So if we have redundancies, so we have to consider maintenance. So one, let's say, safety group could be put offline or bypassed because we do something on that. And we have to consider failure. This is the single failure, so any type, anything in this chain could fail. So we have to consider that, okay, one is, let's say, failed. So usually we have, let's say, if we have three or four, so as you can see, it can be enough. So from this point of view, but it has also some disadvantage. So what can happen if we put more redundancies? So we can fight the single failure. So if this is failed, so we still have two other, or at least one another, to deal with, let's say, the requirements with the safety function. The problem which we can, let's say, introduce by this is spurious actuation, some unwanted actuation. Because as we add more redundancies, we not only increase the, let's say, probability that, okay, everything will work as it is intended, but we also increase the probability that if there is some specific failure, which can lead to some unwanted, let's say, actuation. So this is also more probable in these, let's say, multiple equipments. And the spurious actuation is something which really we don't want. It can be, let's say, the safe state. So the spurious actuation can be the reactor tip. So, okay, we, let's say, put the reactor to the safe state. But from the point of view of, let's say, operation itself, it creates some, let's say, unnecessary stresses to the equipment. And you have learned that, okay, the reactor can survive only, let's say, certain number of such, let's say, fast transients. So we don't want to, let's say, provide if it's not necessary to do such things. Also, we can, let's say, actuate some, let's say, SFAS function. We can, let's say, start pumping the cold water to the reactor, to the primary circuit, which can, let's say, degrade the, let's say, equipment. So really, this is something which we would like to avoid as well. So how to deal with this, let's say, situation? So we implement in some design. It's not, let's say, something which is required, but usually what is implemented is voting logic. Or one solution can be voting logic. So the voting logic, basically what is done, so for, let's say, every division, we, let's say, take into the account not only the outputs of this specific division, but also the outputs from the other divisions as well. So it's not only the one failure, one spurious actuation is not enough to trigger the, let's say, safety action. So it means that we need at least, for example, if we have, for example, three redundancies, we need at least, for example, two, let's say, systems actuating to go through the voting logic and to start the safety functions. What is important, if you implement the voting logic, you have to, let's say, consider some specific states of the trains. Here's example. We don't have time to speak very details about all the possible states, but this is an example for if you have three redundancies. I think usually in the new design nowadays, I think four redundancies are used for the safety systems usually, but with three you can also, it could be also done with three. But you have to consider that, okay, in normal state, two out of three vote, so it's okay. But you have to put consideration that, okay, some part could be in the maintenance, and in another, let's say, division, there could be some failure. And the failure could be such that, okay, it can block the safety signal, or it can introduce the safety signal. So you have to consider different possibilities. So usually you have, for example, some system inhibition when it is, let's say, in the maintenance. You have some, for example, invalidity, or when it's, let's say, evaluated that the systems provide some faulty results. Or you can have some safe position, which, for example, during the maintenance, you switch certain, let's say, outputs to the safe position, to the trip position, because you don't want them to be masked by the fault in another division, and so on. So it's quite complex. We don't have time to, let's say, we can spend a lot of time to discuss different transients. This is just example how it could work. It's not only example, there are many possibilities, and in many designs there can be different possibilities. It's just for this example that if the voting logic is implemented, you have to consider different states of the equipment and to be careful how to implement it. Okay. What is also important together with redundancy, we don't want the failure to, let's say, spread to other redundancies. So what we implement is some, let's say, independence. So the divisions or the safety trains should be, let's say, independent from each other. So if there is a fire in this room, so we have still the other two. And also, we have to consider the common cause failure. Especially with the digital systems, if I create the software for one redundancy, and there is a fault, hidden fault, because it's very complex, and maybe I am not able to test it fully because it's a complex system, software system. So I can very easily copy and paste the same fault to all my other divisions. So the common cause failure, especially for the complex and digital systems, is a very big concern, and we will speak about it also later. This is just, okay, as a fun, so I think it's obvious that also power supply has to be provided independent to each other, let's say, safety train. So you don't want to supply everything from one source, so, because it will be evident common cause. So what we have, so for every safety, let's say, division, we have specific, let's say, diesel generator and a set of batteries. So we have the safety power for each of the train independent to each other to be able to, let's say, supply and to operate all the let's say, equipment in the case of some, let's say, fault in some of this equipment. Okay, redundancy, okay. So it was what I have mentioned. So it has to be redundant to the, let's say, degree to meet reliability requirements, okay, we have mentioned. The elements, redundant elements, should be also independent, okay, I think it's clear. And redundancy can increase the probability of spurious actuation. So one way how to deal is the routing. And also it applies to electrical systems as well. Yeah. So I have mentioned it as well. So independence. So we have mentioned the independence between different, okay, redundancies. In fact, the independence can be seen from, let's say, two point of views. We implement independence in between the redundant, let's say, elements, and also we implement independence between different levels of depth. So there are two, let's say, implementation of, let's say, independence in the plant. So how it can be done? So first and most obvious is physical separation. So I put the equipment to another room or another building. Yeah, I put the wall in between. Electrical isolation. So for example, I do not connect the equipment, or I use some isolation devices, some isolation transformers, some optic communication, electromagnetic qualification. Can also, let's say, provide some, let's say, help here, because if we want to electrically isolate, so perhaps we have to check that also the radiated electrical field is not, let's say, harm our equipment. What is more difficult is, let's say, functional independence or independence of communication. So this is not so easy to evaluate. So what functional independence? So it means that the function of one system doesn't depend on the function or results of another systems. And in fact, in the plant, you will find that the systems in between the different levels of depth are very often connected. There are some reasons for that. There can be some sensor sharing, there can be some, let's say, communication that, for example, the protection system will send some information to some, let's say, information system, provide the information about its state and so on. So there are some connections in between. And we have to be able to, let's say, prove and to evaluate that the, let's say, systems with lower classification, which are less important and less reliable, they couldn't harm our, let's say, safety systems or the systems with, let's say, a higher classification. So it's basically to, let's say, fight the, let's say, spread of the failures. So we don't want the failure to go from one system to another. And this could be, let's say, quite difficult to evaluate. Very often you need some, let's say, specific knowledge of some specific system, how it is implemented to, let's say, provide the, let's say, the proof that the communication link, if it exists, it's safe enough. Here's also some, let's say, consideration about the cables. In the nuclear plant, we have a lot of cables, so we should also implement some separation between different types of cables. So again, we should separate the cables with this different, let's say, safety classification. We also should separate the cables from different safety divisions. So if we have more redundancies, for example, 4 trains, and then we put all the cables in one, let's say, penetration, so it's very weak point where we can really very easily, as a, let's say, common cause failure, let's say, lost all the redundancies. So we also have to, let's say, take care and to separate the cables from different divisions. And also a cable with different voltage. So for example, the communication cables will be not in the same, let's say, the communication lines will be not in the same cable as some, let's say, high voltage, let's say, power cables. Yeah. So this is some, let's say, really basic, let's say, consideration you have to keep in mind when you, let's say, design or, let's say, assess how the system is designed. So you can see the cabling in the plant is not always easy. And you can find some places where there are some, let's say, convergence of the cables. For example, main control room here. Yeah? The cables can converge there, so it can be quite difficult to deal with this. Okay. So let's go. I think we can continue a little bit. I think we have to 12:30, I think. So let's continue a little bit and then we continue. So common cause failure, you already know about it. So we have to consider the common cause failure. It's, as I have mentioned, it's let's say specific concern are for the complex systems. Just as a note, sometimes in the literature you can find common mode or common cause. Usually, and in this presentation, and very often, it's common cause is used for both, and usually it's, let's say, synonym. But sometimes there are some distinction that common mode means the manner, the way how the equipment fails, and the cause is the event which caused the, let's say, the failure. So sometimes it's a very slight difference. Usually it's not very important, but there are some cases when it could be important. So just for your information that, okay, something like this, terminology exists with regards to common cause failure. Okay. So now I have some, let's say, examples of common cause failures. So this is, let's say, environmental common cause failures. I think it's clear. External hazards. So we have mentioned it also during the qualification. This is quite interesting. Maybe someone of you have already seen similar pictures. This is something we can consider hardware common cause. This was taken in one of our plants. And this is called thin whiskers. Maybe you heard about this phenomenon. So it's some, let's say, specific physical phenomenon when this you use the pure metal, in this case, for example, tin. So, and if it's, let's say, exposed to some, let's say, stress, I think it's not, let's say, in detail described how, okay, it works. So some crystal could grow. And if you use the same, let's say, hardware connections in all your safety, like say trains, so you can have the same type of errors in all your of redundancies. And what the Kestrel does, it grows, and then you can have a short circuit. Usually it's very thin, so it's usually disappear, it burns. But usually the equipment does something strange. And when you check, so you find nothing because it disappears. So this is a very specific, let's say, or example of the hardware common cause for error. It could be some corrosion and things like that, but this is quite interesting. So thin whiskers. Here's another example of, let's say, more complicated common cause failure. Software, common cause failure in software, which is usually very difficult to find, and this is why the concern is. So this is a real example, what really happened. And so just very quickly, so here's, let's say, neutron, there's some X-core measurements in wide range, so high-level measurements of neutron power of reactor, which is then shared with, let's say, two different systems. The measurements from ionization chambers go to the post-accident monitoring system, and also it goes to some, let's say, diverse monitoring systems. So normally in the, let's say, normal power, 100%, so everything works as it should. When the, let's say, power drops to a certain level, for example, and this was found when the, let's say, the fuel was taken out from the reactor, so the, let's say, the neutron power in, of the reactor was really minimal because almost nothing. So then the measurement goes to very low numbers, and we find out that not all the software systems are able to cope with such low numbers. And it was because some specific software libraries was used, because a normal, let's say, floating point number are some defined, let's say, range in which it can work. And if it's, let's say, behind the range, so there are several possibilities how to deal with it. I will not go to the details. How one of the possibilities is that, okay, it's, let's say, directly, let's say, assigned the zero, what basically these systems done. But we find out that the post-accident monitoring system, one specific component, and it was some graphical meter, when it was, let's say, on the screen, and this slow value go inside, so it dies, and so we can lose, because of this slow number, we can lose all or three post-accident monitoring systems at once. So it's, let's say, common cause failure. Here's the failure, that the system was not implemented properly, and here was the trigger. The number was too low. Nobody expected something like it can happen, and it caused the, let's say, common cause failure in the software. Fortunately, this system was okay, it was still working, but this is the example of the, let's say, common cause for failure in the software. So let's go through this, and we will stop. So the concept is that, okay, how it is happened. So during the design, when there is some error, the guy who programmed the software makes some error. So we have the fault in the software. The fault alone, perhaps there can be the fault in the software for forever, and maybe we will not find, and it will not cause any problem. But if we have some, like, let's say, activating conditions, something we call trigger, so then the digital failure could, let's say, came to life and can cause something. So if we have activating condition in one division, so we can lose, for example, the function of one division. If we have the same activating conditions, because we have the same failure, copy and paste to all the divisions, and we have the same activating conditions in multiple divisions, so we can use the whole system, and this is the problem. We don't want to be here. And the, let's say, catastrophic scenario is that we have the same error in multiple systems, in multiple levels of dev, and concurrent activating conditions, so we can lose all the systems. So this is the really catastrophic scenario. So that's why we have to really pay attention to the common cause failure. And this is some, let's say, graphical representation. So for common cause failure to occur, we need, let's say, several things. We need to have the faulty system in multiple, let's say, for example, divisions or multiple systems. And we have to do the same concurrent activating conditions. So it's, let's say, not so easy to reach the common cause failure, but because of these systems can be quite complex, so we have to be very careful how to deal with it. And so how to reduce the CCF common cause failure? So it's independence, okay. It's because of common cause failure, because of, for example, fire, flooding, and things like that. Qualification, we have already mentioned that. Yeah, qualification from internal, external hazards. And diversity. I will speak about it also in more details. This is, let's say, the way how we deal with common cause failure, to introduce diverse systems. And also for the complex systems, what we have to done is to focus on development process. So we have to try to avoid the faults during a high quality development process. We also focus to, let's say, detect the faults, because also there are humans here, and if there is some fault, so we have to try to verify, to check, to remove the fault in before the operation itself. So it's for detection, and also some concept as fault tolerance. So if there is some fault and the equipment is faulty, so we don't want so if we would like to, let's say, go in some, let's say, predefined state, we want to prevent the propagation of failures. So these are the, let's say, basic concepts how to deal with common cause failure. So just let's speak about the common, this diversity, and maybe we will stop here then and have a break for a lunch. So the diversity, there are a lot of literature about different approaches to diversity and the different categories, different terminology. But let's say the basic approaches are, it's usually the functional and signal diversity. It usually goes together. It's the approach is that, okay, the safety function, the same safety function is based on, let's say, different logic, different algorithms using, for example, different sensors. So, for example, if I would like to, I don't know, evaluate the LOCA conditions. So one way is, for example, I measure the pressure inside the primary circuit. And another approach is I measure the pressure, for example, in the containment. Yeah? So for many safety functions, we can find different, let's say, physical, let's say, symptoms, which can be caused by some event, and we can evaluate using different approaches. So this is very, let's say, very important, and one of the most, let's say, useful way how to deal with the CCF. It's not only. There are other approaches. We can use design diversity or equipment diversity. So in fact, we implement the functions into completely different equipment. So we have, for example, computer-based system, and then we have some another relay-based or FPGA-based system, which use different design, different, let's say, design principles. So there is, let's say, a lower probability that the same, let's say, error will be in two different systems. We can use human or logic diversity. So during the development, some part of development is done by different people, different software tools, or, let's say, procedures are used. So these are, let's say, basic examples of how to implement the diversity. Okay, and okay, so last slide. So this is just to demonstrate. So I will not speak a lot of it. So usually you have some diverse systems. So you have usually control systems. You have protection system, which, okay, can be some, let's say, primary protection system. Maybe you have some, let's say, diverse protection system because of the consideration of common cause failure. You have post-accident monitoring system. Very often they are diverse to each other. It's usually because of, let's say, these systems are, let's say, for example, not classified. So I use, let's say, some industrial standard. These are usually some specific systems which require different design. So I usually introduce some design diversity together with the plan design as well. It has to be, let's say, independent. So this is the independence in between the different levels of depth. But what is important, the life is not perfect. And very often we find, let's say, some communication links in between the systems. We find some, let's say, places where these systems go together to one place, for example, the control room. So then during the evaluation, we have to put attention, or pay attention to these, let's say, specific connection to avoid the failure propagation and to check if the independence is, let's say, correctly implemented. And I think last slide before the break. And let's say the common cause failure or the diversity from the point of view of, let's say, electrical systems. So we usually don't, let's say, have a lot of trouble with electrical system because the diversity is, let's say, somehow implemented based on the, let's say, the characteristics of the electrical systems itself. So basically, the let's say different diverse systems are, let's say, the off-site power. We have turbo generator. It's very different. We have the standby diesel generators, and we have some alternate AC power. So usually we have to put attention to have diverse systems in this level because they are, let's say, same type of system. So this is the place when the diversity is, let's say, most concerned. Okay, so I think let's stop here. I think it's time for a lunch break. So after the lunch, we will continue with this presentation. So maybe are there any questions to the what we have seen so far? I hope we will have more time at the end. I will try to, let's say, maybe go a little bit more quickly, but I think we will finish it on time. So if there are no questions, so I think we have till 2 o'clock. So 2 p.m. we will continue with this presentation. So thank you for your attention and bon appetit.